Emerson, and she has a board of directors update.
I think we should give Beth a hand. Good job. I know as I look across this room that there are some terrific prayer warriors in this crowd. So I wanted to give you just a quick update on what's going on at Laternal for the future. Last night we had a meeting and a 10-year, it's hard to believe, 10-year vision plan was presented. And I'd like to ask you to just pray for Laternal and the future, because God is blessing even in the middle of the coronavirus shutdown. We have been able to pay our bills, which is a big deal, because we had some reserve funds. And you know that some events were canceled, so that meant no money was coming in. However, God is blessing through it all. So would you pray for Laternal as you have your prayer time? Anytime you think of it, pray for Laternal. The 10-year plan is exciting. And someday I'll share more about it, but I would just ask you to pray. Thank you.
I have a couple other announcements for you. First, we are very excited to announce that the speaker for the September luncheon is going to be Margie Stevens. She will be back with us again in September. And so we look forward to hearing what God is doing in her life and seeing her amazing artwork. If you haven't heard Margie before, you're going to really want to be with us next month. And who knows, I might even wear another hat. So also, you have an opportunity today to make your reservation for next month before you leave. Now, if you do that and you, for some reason, cannot make the luncheon next month, you need to call and cancel your reservation. Please, please, please. It impacts the kitchen greatly, and it impacts the work that we do as a team greatly when people don't let us know that they're not coming. So please, please keep that in mind. Secondly, after the luncheon today, the gift and coffee shop at the south end of the building will be open for your perusal, and they have some really cool things if you haven't had a chance to get in there and look. Also, when you leave today, please notice the door you came in is only, if you came in the side doors, that is only an entrance door. You have to leave by a different door today. So by the table, Renee is being Vanna back there. She is showing you the door that you will exit. And also, if you go to the gift shop and exit through that door, one side is entrance and one side is exit. So make sure you're using the right side. Yes, ma'am. Jason?
That would be the door that Renee was pointing at right over there. It'll be the one from inside here, not the one through the threshold, just the one that actually leads the diamond.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. And now, Jason, a couple of quick Laternal announcements.
Hey, so how long can I talk so I don't have to wear the mask for a few minutes? All right, ladies, check it out. So on the little table right back there, right this side of where you guys registered, you're going to see a whole lot of these right here. So as Carol mentioned a minute ago, we did have to cancel a few events. However, God gave us so much grace and such a blessing. We had so many kids this summer for camp, and we are still at this point, Lord willing, we're doing our fall festival, which will be a free event for families. And with that, we have our 5K run walk, which is a fundraiser for our children's ministries here. So please, if you would, take a flyer. It's going to be on Halloween this year. We're going to have lots of games for the kids, tons of candy. Like I said, there's going to be a 5K. We're going to do a chicken barbecue. So I've got lots of flyers on the little table that look just like this. Take them back to your church. If you've got a business, take them to your business. If any of you ladies are runners or walkers, then there's also a little registration cards. Or if you know anybody that runs or walks, I don't even know if I need this thing. If you know anybody that runs or walks, then you can take a registration form to them as well. But this is an opportunity. Like I said, the event is the Fall Festival event is free for families, for kids. The 5K is an opportunity to bless the kids that come to our different ministries like the Easter egg hunt, the fall festival, our day camps during the summer. So all the proceeds go to children's and youth ministry here at Laterno. So thank you very much, ladies.
Okay, now the moment you've all been waiting for, door prizes. No tickets. Because of COVID, we're doing it a little bit different. So anybody who had made a reservation today, you were entered in a drawing for a door prize. And so we pulled four names to cut down on germs. So, oh. No, I just can't read it. It's not in 48 font. Oh, Judy Newcomb. If I get it far enough, I can read it. Sharon Carter. Sally Eshelman. And Gail Bender. Okay. So, now the moment we've all been waiting for. I know you didn't really all come for the door prizes. Or my hat, but that's okay. Diane Drumm is here to speak to us today, and I just want to tell you how amazing she is and how special to my heart she is. I have known Diane for a while, a long while. I was lucky enough to get to know Diane. Well, Diane was a friend of my parents first, and then I was lucky enough to get to know her through a community cantata that we sang together in. And then I was lucky enough to get to go to church with her. How cool is that? So she has such a heart for the Lord and has shown such amazing strength and I don't know, sustenance and peace, and just she's a model of godly love to her friends, to her family, and to her church. And so can we just take a minute to pray for Diane and her support team up here? And then we'll ask Diane to come forward and minister to us. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the gift that you have given to Diane, for her spirit, for her love, and her ability to shine your light from her being. Lord, we just ask you to give her the strength that she needs to witness to us today, to share her testimony and share her love for you. And we just ask for Davina and Julianne and Karen to just be able to support Diane through their music and just minister to each one of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Diane, welcome. Everybody, welcome.
On Jordan's stormy banks I stand and cast a wistful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land where my possessions lie. I am bound for the promised land, I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go with me? I am bound for the promised land, promised land. Shall we gather at the river where bright angels' feet have trod? With this crystal tide forever flowing from the throne of God. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful, beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows from the throne of God. Throne of God. Gonna lay down my burden down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside. Gonna lay down my burden down by the riverside, down by the riverside, the riverside. Gonna lay down my burden
down by
the riverside. Riverside, gonna lay down my burden down by the riverside, down by the river, the riverside, the riverside, flowing from the throne of God, the throne of God. I'm bound for the promised land, the promised land.
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Wait a minute, which mic am I supposed to use? I think it's this one. Okay. Well, I am privileged to be here to speak with you today. I'm glad you don't have your masks on. That looks a little strange. And thank you for coming. It's wonderful to be healthy enough to do so. Amen? Amen? So I thought we could have kind of a kitchen table type talk like we do so easily as women. We just sit and chit-chat easily. And if we could just think of this like a conversation, even though it's not the easiest topic, but let's do it just to make us all think. Okay? If you've noticed the topic for discussion, eternity, ready or not, it's a phrase I believe the Lord impressed upon me because I see this question hovering over people I am with almost every single day up until March. My husband Steve is in a nursing facility with end stages of Alzheimer's. He's been there almost 5 years. And actually, people there, so many of them, do not know Jesus. Realistically, they will not leave there until they die. Actually, if this and other places like it were filled with Christians waiting to enter heaven, it would be a much more delightful place to be, would it not? However, in comparing my caregiving experiences two things I observe nowadays. It seems to me that we need to have end-of-life discussions. And why not? We're all going to die someday. Amen? And if we're a Christian, it should be our all-time greatest joy, heaven and seeing Jesus face to face. So, if I approached any one of you here today and said, if tonight you were going to die in your sleep, would you be ready? Would you be absolutely sure where you would be in a split second? With no opportunity to come back and change anything. No opportunity to say goodbye to those you love. To encourage them to know the Lord or to grow in the Lord. No opportunity to forgive someone or be forgiven by someone. Would you leave all your relationships clear and feel good about everything you've left behind? What would you do? And how would you respond? It seems, at least in our society, as families, we do not openly discuss this topic very much, if at all. As I wrote this talk, I received a call from a man who had lived with us when he was a teenager. We became fill-in parents when his family fell apart. And he was lamenting how unprepared everyone was in his family for the death of his mom. No one else in his family knows the Lord, and they were all looking to him for everything. This timely call just strengthened my resolve to give this talk. Because initially, when the Lord put this on my heart, I thought, I don't know if I want to talk about that. You know, but talking with him, it changed my mind a little bit. We planned for marriage. We planned for a home. We buy life insurance, home insurance, health insurance, car insurance, all kinds of things like that. We plan for education for ourselves and for our children. We plan for vacations. We plan for retirement. And yet, we so often neglect the most important event that we will all experience in our life as we transition from life here on earth into eternity. What an oversight. So I thought it would be good to consider this topic in light of three areas: faith, fear, and forgiveness. First and foremost, we need to make absolutely sure of the salvation promised us by the Lord. Many people attend church all their lives, but do not know the Lord in a personal way. In the Gospel of John, Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said to you, you must be born again." Two examples from the nursing home. One man I'll call Fred. He had lovely Christian children who had talked with him, prayed with him for years, and he would have nothing to do with what he called religion. He was very resistant. Then one day when I went to the nursing home to help Steve with lunch. I noticed Fred was not at the table. Suddenly, unfortunately, the night before, he had passed away. The sad part of that is that there was no indication that he ever had had a relationship with Jesus. The aide that cared for him said to me, "He was so frightened." She said, oftentimes she can tell those who know the Lord and those who don't by their responses. And of course, we can't see into a person's heart like God can. But there was no outward sign that Fred had died in faith. Then there was Andy. Andy was a man in his early 60s who had had 5 strokes. We had become acquainted and talked most every day because at that point we were the only 2 people at the table that could converse. Over time, we began to speak about spiritual things. But he became steadily anxious. He said one day that he felt he was going to have another stroke and he didn't know what would happen to him then. So we talked some more. He said he had always wanted to be a Christian, but he just didn't know how. Well, if somebody says that kind of thing to you, you can imagine. We prayed together that day, right there in the dining room. Andy asked Jesus into his heart. He asked Jesus to forgive all of his sin. He thanked him for dying for him and giving him a new life and a future. He was so intentional and so focused. 4 days later, Andy did have another stroke. I went to his room and prayed with him, and he died that night. That same aide, that lovely Christian gal who had cared for Fred, was also with Andy. And she said to me, "Diane, he was so peaceful. I praise God for that. I am as certain as anyone can be that Andy is in heaven today. And what a blessing." Now I have to tell you a strange thing that happened after that. The next day, as I was down there helping Steve with lunch, Andy walked into the dining room. I kid you not. It took my breath away. I was so shocked. Then I remembered Andy had a twin brother, an identical twin. I had the TV on one Sunday before church, and a pastor many of you would know was speaking in Washington, D.C. And I quote, "When we die, there are 2 destinations. With certainty, we will all die, be resurrected and changed, some with Christ and some without Christ. Some will be in the presence of God in heaven, and some will be in hell." Unquote. He said, we all don't go to the same place. And heaven, as we understand and believe, is a beautiful place, where Revelation 21 says, God himself will be with them, and he will be their God, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Unquote. But some will be in hell, where we're told that there is suffering and weeping and gnashing of teeth and loneliness forever. So, it's about our choice, even today. For we don't know what tomorrow will bring. We need to prepare and walk by faith. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 4, we do not lose heart, For even though our outward man is perishing, the inward man is being renewed day by day. So we need to be pleasing to him and get to know him as our Lord. John 3:16, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Again, it's all about our relationship with the Lord, isn't it? Have you asked Jesus into your heart to be your Savior? And not only that, to be your Lord, to be Lord of your life, to forgive you of every single sin? Have you thanked him for all he's done, for dying for you on that ugly cross, to give you new life? That's our salvation, ladies, and it's so important that we come to know him on his terms. You know, the Lord is so good. He loves us so much. And he even gives us the choice in this. We're created with a free will to choose him. And by his wonderful grace, he enables us to believe and walk with him by faith every day. How can we not want to be with him forever? Now let's consider fear. Fear is something so prevalent today. Some of us are fearful of what we see and hear happening around us. Hateful things, violent things. It's hard to believe it's real sometimes. We fear safety for our families, our schools, our churches, and our country. But what is it we're really fearing? Isn't it death? Or suffering, or loss of some kind? How we need to trust the Lord with all of our hearts and lean not to our own understanding. For we can't explain why things happen the way they do. Death and suffering are a mystery sometimes. We must accept that his ways are not our ways. And his thoughts are not our thoughts. And remember that he has purposes for everything. He tells us in his word that end times will be very dark and difficult. And yet, Isaiah 43 says, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by my name. You are mine." Psalm 23, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." Psalm 34, "I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears." Romans 8, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing can separate me from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." And that pretty well sums up a lot, doesn't it? If God has said in his word to us that we don't have to fear, then we need to believe it. So then we can face our dying day with peace and confidence. Realistically, the only thing we should fear is dying without Jesus. So we prepare ahead. Now, I know what it's like to fear death personally. Right after I graduated from college, my mom died of cancer. She was a beautiful woman, inside and out. She was a woman of faith. She was only 47 years old. And she suffered horribly. They didn't use much morphine or many strong drugs back then. And she was in great pain. Unlike today, where medicines take away so much of that discomfort and suffering. I remember watching her and trying to slip my hand underneath the oxygen tent to hold her hand. That was my first experience with death. And truthfully, I was terrified. She was at peace with God, but her pain was horrific. I was so frightened, I put a chair outside of her door and I sat there. I would go in her room occasionally to look at her, but then I would go back outside by her doorway and sit. The doctor would come by and say to me, "Diane, why don't you go home? You can't do anything to help her this way." But I couldn't. I was just so torn. Can you guess how the Lord healed me of that fear? By putting me with dying people. That is why one motivation for caring for all of our family members was to enable them to take their last breath in the comfort of home. I can now say that death does not frighten me. In fact, I look forward to it at times. It's the doorway to heaven. And what's better than that? One more example. My grandmother that we cared for died when she was 98 years old. She had been a Christian most all of her life. She'd sit in her wheelchair and sing hymns to herself. And she loved to be with us on our Wednesday night home church meetings. When she died, she was very aware of what was happening to her. And she was ready. She was quiet, peaceful, no apparent discomfort. I had to turn her over like every 10 or 15 minutes because her circulation was so poor. Finally, in the midst of one of those turns, I realized that she was fading fast. And as I was cradling her in my arms, she was too weak to speak. Her eyes were closed, but she mouthed the words, "Thank you," to me. And in a split second, she was gone. So serene, so peaceful, so beautiful. I treasure that memory, and I would love to die just like that. Who wouldn't?
Concerned for the loved ones you believe. beyond the shadow of death. Angels led you from this life to your home in the sky. What did you see when you opened your eyes and looked past this life to eternity? Did you
many of us might have some apprehension about the process of dying. Will I have an illness? Will I have a heart attack? Will it be long or short? Will I have pain or not? These are just normal thoughts. We're dealing with an unknown, and we've not experienced it for ourselves before. It's totally out of our control. We've not experienced it personally, even though we may have experienced it standing beside someone. That's where we put our faith to work. We place our total trust in God. Think beyond ourselves. Picture Jesus in some way. Recall his words. Listen for his voice. And let go. Just release yourself to him. How precious that can be. The Bible doesn't tell us all we'd like to know about death, but it does tell us some things. 1 Corinthians 15 says, "But some will say, 'How are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come?' Oh, foolish one. What you sow is not made alive until it dies. And what you sow, you do not sow the body that shall be, but mere grain. And God gives it a body as he pleases. To each seed its own body. All flesh is not the same flesh. But there is one kind of flesh of man, another kind of flesh of animals. And there are celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, another glory of the stars. So is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, and it is raised a spiritual body."
Terror of tempestuous sea.
I have a friend some of you would know, and his attitude is, bring it on, Lord, I'm ready. Let's remember, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and a sound mind to think this out. If we seek him, he will deliver us from all our fears. He says so in his word, and he always keeps his promises. He's such a good father. So let's trust him and give him glory in this way, by dying in faith in anticipation of all of his promises. Now, regarding forgiveness, if we are real and honest with ourselves, we need to acknowledge that we are all equally human and flawed. It's not always easy to get along with people. Sometimes it's good to check ourselves and admit that we need a little spiritual scrubbing here and there to clean up our hearts. God sees and knows us inside and out. He hears our unspoken thoughts. He knows our attitudes. He knows every motive. He sees every action. We may fool people sometimes, but we can never hide anything from God. The more we realize our own failings, the easier it should be for us to forgive others. Thus, we need not resist the idea of forgiveness. We are like walking mirrors. We are all selfish. We are all sinful. Psalm 139 says, "You have searched me and known me. You understand my thoughts from afar. You are acquainted with all my ways, and there is not a word on my tongue. But behold, O Lord, you know it altogether." God is with us every moment of our lives, and he knows it all. And he still died for us. He seeks us out, and he has made a way for us to be with him forever. What a loving, forgiving Heavenly Father we have. So in terms of forgiveness, let's put aside all reservation and think this out. In the nursing home, there are some people who are just left there. No visitors. They are so alone. How much unforgiveness do they have buried deep in their hearts? I know of a woman whose family told her they were building a place for her in their home to come live with them. They're not doing that. Some go into a facility with bitter experiences they have lived with all their lives. But with no relationship with God, they have no good way of handling it. So they die in all that negativity. Others, when they develop dementia, can become irrational, often irritable, and that causes relational breakdown. It's all so very sad, ladies. But it doesn't have to be that way. God can give us gentle spirits and forgiving hearts. If there is anyone you know that you have hurt or offended, maybe even years ago, pray. And if at all possible, go to that person and settle whatever it is in peace. Ask forgiveness. Do your part, regardless of the other party's response. I have done this a number of times. Or if someone has deeply hurt you, pray. God will help you forgive that person. Otherwise, we are in error. The Lord will help us. He wants this for us. My most recent experience with this began a number of years ago. I was involved in a business situation with one person versus another, and I just didn't feel good about it. I did what I was advised to do, but I felt I had wronged one party. I prayed and prayed about this and just could not figure out how to practically resolve it. Well, leave it to the Lord. Didn't this person show up in the nursing home where I go every day? I knew this was a divine setup and an answer to my prayers. Thank you, Lord. He's so good. The next day we had a conversation and he graciously forgave me. It's humbling to admit a wrong. But you know, it is so freeing. He said, "Diane, there are no hard feelings about that." Oh, I tell you, he was so kind, and the load that was lifted off me in that moment made it almost worth all the years I carried it and struggled with it. I felt so free. Forgiveness, to me at least, is one of the greatest gifts God has given to us. There's nothing quite as liberating as a clear conscience. And because it's God's will, He will help us. Forgiveness removes guilt. Guilt lifted allows peace and rest in the soul, and contentment in the Lord in this way is a beautiful thing. Colossians 3 says, "Forgive one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ has forgiven you, so you must do." Ephesians 4 says, "Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ has forgiven you." 1 John says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Psalm 86, "For you, Lord, are ready to forgive and abundant in mercy." We are told we need to be like Jesus. Well, if we want to be like Him, then we need to exercise forgiveness. both by giving it and receiving it. In conclusion, what is the overall perspective here? In regard to the nursing home, there are just so many people there who are spiritually unprepared for this time in their lives. They are simply at the mercy of their caregivers for their failing minds and bodies. They need people like you and me to speak to them lovingly, to care for them. If you are ever motivated in that way, it would be a wonderful ministry. As for you and me, let's ask the Lord, is there anything in particular in relation to my life that you would want me to do before I leave this earth? Anything at all? Let's draw close to him. Let's make our time count for good, not by activities, but by relationships with him and with others. Take time to be quiet before him. Days pass so quickly. Let's be able to live our lives in such a way that we will have no regrets. Importantly, let's make time with our families, loved ones, need to hear us talk about our relationship with the Lord and things that have meant the most to us in our lifetime. What your hopes would be for them. Do it while there's time. Give them opportunity to ask questions, to discuss whatever may be on their hearts. Give them freedom to talk. Reassure them of your love. And make it count for good for those you love and care about. And as we have already discussed, deal with matters of faith, fear, and forgiveness. A quote from our Daily Bread devotional says, "Help me then to settle right now the question, is it well with my soul? Then may I so order my life day by day, whether my summons comes at dawn, noonday, sunset, or midnight, that I shall be found ready, with loins girded and lamp burning, like one looking for the Lord." So, ladies, if this time does nothing else this morning, I hope it causes you to think, to be grateful for your lives here, and to look forward to the day when you enter heaven, ready for eternity. Thank you. If you feel comfortable, let's stand and sing together. You can spread out if you like, and we'll sing a song that you all probably know.
Thank you. We're blessed. We're looking forward to giving you guys a wonderful meal today. So I've got my nice little cheat sheet out here somewhere because there's a lot of instructions. COVID makes everything complicated, but we are not complainers. I've told people all along the season that I want to get shirts printed out, and I just haven't done it yet. Be positive, right? Be positive. We're children of the King. Be positive. So let me just share a little bit of how this works today. You obviously know you're spread out pretty far. It adds a bunch of tables, so our staff is doubled today in order to serve. And we're going to take care of drinks first, so maybe you need some more coffee or something like that. Lily is a server that's going to take care of this side. So Lily, raise your hand so they know who they are looking for coffee from. That's Lily in the back. On this side, Renee is going to take care of your coffee and water needs on this side. If you would like a soda today, Savannah, raise your hand. That's my beautiful young daughter, by the way. She's growing up on me. I can only have her for so many more years before, you know, she's tired of me and leaves me. But anyway, Savannah would love to take care of your soda needs. So if you'd like to get a Pepsi or something, you can walk over there. But in order not to swamp her, if you don't mind, we'll start on the right side today in terms of soda drinks so that if there's 20 people, they're not overwhelmed. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, you'll walk to her for sodas today. Yep, the coffee and the water will come to you. Sodas, if you'll go to her, that'll make things a little easier. All right, in terms of how we'll serve you, we're going to serve you a salad first this morning. We'll have a house salad with some dressings coming around. Marianne will bring your dressings, so the person who is bringing your salad will drop that off. If you don't want one, just let them know, and that'll be fine. And then there is a lot of staff that will take care of your needs in terms of the main entree. So for this side, these four tables over there, you guys are so blessed today. You get the most awesome, I shouldn't talk too heavily of him. He'll get a big head. You get me. So, yeah, I'll be taking care of you four tables today. And then right here is Jason. So you guys get Jason right there. And then he's standing right where he should. This is Shane, Renee's husband. He'll be taking care of you guys. And over on the left, you get the wonderful expert, Miss Sarah. She will not mess it up or dump it on your lap, I promise. Don't let me down, Sarah. All right, just as a reminder, if you do need to get up and use the restroom or something like that, just remember your mask. We're heavily protected, of course, by the Lord, but we're also heavily mandated by the state. So if our inspector comes in, because it's summer and that can happen, I'd love to look like we know what we're doing. And so if you get up, please feel free to put your mask back on, and we'd appreciate that much. All right, so for the rest of the meal today, we prepared a macaroni salad with pasta, olives, and fresh veggies, a awesome cucumber salad. You'll get to try that as well. It's got tomato, cucumber, onion, and then a special sauce, a dressing, Italian. And then you've got a chicken salad croissant sandwich today with some chips on the side. And then for dessert, a wonderful strawberry shortcake, which is perfect time for this year. All right. So all of that today, we will pray and then be patient with us because this is quite different. We will start with a salad and go through the pasta and go through the macaroni salad and then bring your entree. So it'll probably take about 20 minutes to get all of that food. So just enjoy the four-course meal today. All right. Well, let's pray and just thank the Lord for all that he's done. Father, we do want to give you praise and glory, Lord. You are the God who is in control of all things. There's not a molecule in all of your creation that is outside of your control, and there is no events that happen beyond your means to correct. And Father, we just pray that you would just work in our lives, continue to make us positive, make us content with your providence and your guidance in our lives. We pray, Lord, that we would be a gospel witness to those around us that do need the gospel, especially in this time where many are overcome by fear. And Lord, we just pray that you would work in the situation to bring about a great revival, even in this community. So we pray, Lord, that you would just pour out your spirit on us. And these ladies, they are instrumental in their community, whether that be they're in their actual families, in their jobs if they have them, or Father, in their neighborhoods and in their churches. So we pray that you'd use them wherever you have planted them for the spread of your gospel. And Lord, we do pray for sweet fellowship today. This is such a blessing to get to be with these ladies again for the first time in months. We thank you that you've made a way for this to happen. We pray, Lord, that you would just bless the fellowship. May it be sweet, may it be beneficial, may it be edifying. And Father, we just pray that you be glorified and we'd be full of joy this day. In Christ's name, amen. All right, ladies. Well, we're looking forward to serving you. Coffee is coming your way right now, so you can just let them know if you have that need. We'll be around with some food in just a moment.